In ancient Egypt, gods lived among humans and ruled the earth. They can be easily distinguished because they are much taller than the average person, have golden blood, and can transform into all sorts of fearsome monsters. Osiris is the king of all the land provided by the Nile, while his brother Set rules the barren desert, and this isolation has made him bitter. In the end, Osiris decided to transfer the throne to his son, Horus, who is associated with the goddess Hathor. He cares for Hathor so much that he gifted him one of Egypt's greatest treasures, a bracelet of 40 stars, which can drive away demons. On the day of the coronation, everyone comes to celebrate, including every god but also every mortal in the city. This includes Zaya and her boyfriend Beak, a thief who doesn't hesitate to steal imaginary items to cheer up his girlfriend, and maybe one day run away together. After all, the gods have given their greetings, and the mortals have left their offerings, Osiris makes a speech and prepares to place the crown on Horus. However, they are interrupted by the arrival of Set, who pretends to be here with a gift but soon fills the place with his own army. He then hands Osiris over to the staff their father had given him and asks for battle because he believes it is his turn to rule. Osiris refuses to fight his brother, so Set kills him on the spot and declares himself the new king of Egypt. His first new rule is that not everyone will be able to easily go to the afterlife. From now on, humans will have to pay out of their fortunes. Horus will not stand up for this and immediately begins fighting Set to avenge his father. They are both very good warriors with a similar level of skill, so they end up transforming into metal beast forms to continue fighting in the sky. To aid their master, Set metaphor appears and reflects the sun on their shields to blind Horus, giving Set the opportunity to claim victory and take Horus' eyes. Set is about to kill Horus as well, but Hathor comes and offers herself to him in exchange for Horus' life. Thus, Horus is banished instead. 1 year later, most of Egypt has been enslaved by Set, and they now lack the money to have another life. Some of the gods tried to defeat him to save the kingdom, but they all died, while Hathor continues to play the role of lover patron to survive. Zaya is a slave to Set's architect, Orsho, who is working on building the tallest obelisk Egypt has ever seen. Beak has been sent to do manual labor, but whenever he gets the chance, he sneaks into Urshu's office to visit Zaya. One afternoon, Zaya shows Bay that Set's army will return with spoils from the wars, which means his vault will be unlocked in the evening, and this is the perfect opportunity for Bay to sneak in and retrieve the eyes of Horus. To help him, Zaya steals the pyramid plans from Urshu, replacing them with blank parchments. When night falls, Beak jumps from a roof into the carriage carrying the gold, which is soon thrown into the vault. There, Beak uses the plans to avoid most traps, but he accidentally activates one anyway. And there's a third bridge that isn't on the plans at all. Fortunately, Beak is quick and nimble, so he dodges every attack and reaches the statue guarding one of Horus' eyes. When he grabs the eye, he falls into a pit full of scorpions, but thankfully, the light of the eye keeps them away. In the morning, Beak goes to see Zaya again, but Urshu has discovered the switcher and is waiting for him with a bunch of guards. Beak uses the eye to blind them all and escapes with his girlfriend. But as they run away in a carriage, Urshu shoots his bow from the balcony and kills Zaya. Moments later, they arrive at the temple where Horus hides, and Beak gets attacked by Horus with the staff. When he doesn't immediately give him the eye back, Beak promises to do it if Horus revives Zaya. And Horus accepts to try, but his efforts are pointless. She's not hurt, she's already dead, and he can't cure mortality. Horus summons Anubis, the god of death, who takes Zaya's soul to the underworld to be judged. Beak is worried because she won't be able to pay the fee to the afterlife, So after Horus takes back his eye, Vic offers a deal. If Horus comes up with a way to save Zaya, Vic will show him the way into the pyramid to get the other eye. Horus accepts after explaining he may get some extra benefits if he becomes king again. And they take off after hiding Zaya in the temple. Meanwhile, Seth's sending his army to attack another goddess stronghold when he learns about the missing eye. By the time Seth goes to Horus' temple, his nephew is already gone. But he does find Zaya's body and takes her necklace after sending his men to find Horus. Back to Horus and Vic. They're currently climbing a mountain because Horus can't transform without both eyes. And he needs help to defeat Set. Once they reach the top, Horus prays to his grandfather, the god of the sun, for a blessing that temporarily allows him to transform again. And fly with Vic towards the solar divine vessel where Ra lives. Here, Ra's duty is to fight the shadow beast Apophis every day and keep it away from Egypt. Ra refuses to get involved in Set's conflict because he believes in staying neutral where his sons are concerned. Not willing to play favorites, however, he does allow Horus to fill a flask with the waters that surround the vessel. Back in Egypt, the last standing rebel gods have retreated behind their walls. So Set takes the chance to visit his ex-wife Nephthys and takes her wings from her. At the solar vessel, Ra temporarily grants Horus some power so he can fly back with Vic, but he loses it as soon as they get closer to the ground and have a rather inelegant landing. Next, they need to use the flask of water to kill the dessert, which would weaken Set greatly, but first Horus sends Vic to gather some regular water to drink near the waterfall. Vic is ambushed by Set's Minotaur army, led by Nevis. Fortunately, Horus quickly comes to his rescue and easily defeats them all. But Nevis is only pretending to be dead. He waits for the right moments to push Horus and Vic off the waterfall before fleeing. And the only reason the pair survives is thanks to Horus' staff. Nevis reports back to Set, who kills him for having failed and sends his mighty hunters after Horus. Then, Set asks Hathor to take him to the underworld, since she has access there, because she used to be counselor to the dead. Hathor pretends she'll think about it, and when she has a free moment, she uses her powers on the sand to make it show her how Horus is doing. When Set finds her, he finally realizes Hathor still loves Horus and she's been lying all this time. So he tries to kill her, but Hathor escapes by opening a portal with her bracelet. At Osiris' tomb, Vic and Horus are pausing their walk back to the city to take a rest. Suddenly, Set's hunters show up riding giant snakes. And it's dangerous for Horus to fight them because he can't stand their venom in his current state. Vic devises a plan without delay. He proposes that he will act as bait and lure the serpent towards him, while Horus conceals himself among the walls. Once the serpent approaches, Horus will make a surprise attack. Their first attempt is unsuccessful, as the serpent survives the attack and the staff is lodged in its mouth. In their second attempt, Vic prolongs his distraction while Horus leaps onto the serpent and slays its rider. The serpent plunges off a cliff with no direction. However, there is still one more serpent to defeat before they can deal with it. Hathor appears and uses her authority to reclaim the staff and sets the serpent ablaze. The trio escapes unharmed, but Horus is unhappy to see Hathor and accuses her of being a traitor, unbeknownst to him. She had to act in self-defense. Vic reveals their plan to obtain the other eye, but Hathor warns them of the Sphinx that guards the pyramid and will execute anyone who cannot solve its riddle dot in an effort to seek help. Horus turns to the god of wisdom, but he continues to bicker with Hathor on their way there. Tired of being disregarded, Hathor strikes up a conversation with Vic instead and is stunned to learn about Horus' pledge. Although she knows it is impossible to bring Zaya back, she refrains from commenting. Shortly after, they arrive at Thoth's temple. where numerous copies of the god can be found because he only trusts himself. Thoth refuses to join their quest and instead advises them to bring the riddle to him, an idea that would result in one of their deaths. To change his mind, Vic strokes Thoth's ego by claiming that he would tell the Sphinx that Thoth feared answering the riddle incorrectly. The group proceeds to make their way towards the pyramid, and Hathor uses the opportunity to reprimand Horus for making unattainable promises to Vic. However, Horus feels justified because his deception is for the greater good. As they approach the pyramid, Horus decides to wait until nightfall to pass undetected, while Thoth reminds Horus of Hathor's past as Set's lover. Zaya employs her magic to project an image of herself waiting in line to be judged onto the sand. For Bic to see, Hathor, who used to guide souls, can communicate with the dead and permits Bic to send a message to Zaya about his efforts to bring her back. However, their conversation is cut short by the arrival of Anubis. As night falls, the group approaches the pyramid and notices that it is continuously moving. Vic selects a random door and enters, using his parkour skills to navigate a moving bridge that leads him to the control wheel, which he uses to stop the pyramid's movement. The entire group can now enter and proceed towards the Sphinx together. However, Thoth incorrectly answers the Sphinx's riddle, resulting in it attacking them. Hathor and Vic step back, while Horus confronts the Sphinx, and Thoth offers potential answers, until he eventually guesses the correct one, causing the Sphinx to crumble. The group is then able to advance towards the pyramid's center, where they must release the water. But they fall into a trap. Set appears and captures Thoth's brain while trapping Hathor and Horus in a cage. Vic tries to proceed with the plan, but Set interrupts him by revealing that Horus lied and showing him Zaya's necklace. Although uncertain about whom to believe, Vec's hesitation enables Set to steal the flask from him and destroy it. Set departs, hoping that the pyramid's collapse will kill the group. But Horus manages to free his friends and escape using the control wheel as cover. Outside the pyramid, Vic confronts Horus about his lies and concludes that the gods do not care about their people. Hathor believes that Vic deserves compensation for all the lies that were told, so she summons Anubis and offers herself in exchange for Anubis granting Vic passage to the underworld. Anubis agrees, and before being taken away, Hathor kisses Horus and leaves her bracelet behind for Beck's protection against the demons. Using the bracelet, Vic safely enters the underworld and begins searching for Zaya in the queue outside the gate, where the rich can pay for the afterlife and the poor are dissolved. Meanwhile, Set is enhancing his beast transformation by adding Thoth's brain, Osiris' heart, Horus's eye, and Nephthys's wings to his magic armor. He then flies to the solar vessel to seek revenge on his father for exiling him to the desert. Ra informs Set that he was wrong, and that all of this has always been a test. Ra gave Osiris the crown and knew he had to relinquish that power when the time came. So he passed his test. Set was given the desert as a test of patience, because Ra wants his son to take over the vessel one day. Set is enraged by this and proceeds to attack his father, but Ra fights back with his solar beam, which no god should be able to survive. However, Set has the power of multiple gods and is able to defeat Ra. Before releasing Apophis, Vic locates Zaya in the underworld and aims to offer her the bracelet to pay for her afterlife. But their reunion is short-lived as Apophis attacks, and Anubis must shut the gates. Zaya convinces Vic to give Horus another chance, and Vic uses the bracelet to return to Egypt, where he teams up with Horus once more. With the assistance of Nephthys' courage, the pair returns to the city, where Set commands Apophis to assault the Nile. From atop the obelisk, wielding Ra's spear, Horus and Vic kidnap Irshu, an architect, To gain entry to the obelisk, Horus ascends the structure by climbing, while Yershu and Bik use the elevator, which leads to a fight between the two. The elevator catches fire, causing Bik to jump off with a rope as Yershu falls. At the top of the obelisk, Horus faces off against Set, with Bik arriving for a surprise attack. After removing the eye from Set's helmet, Bik is thrown back by Set, but he tosses the eye to Horus. Horus decides to save Bik rather than the eye, apologizes to him, and transforms into his beast form, fighting Set while causing the obelisk to crumble. After killing Set with Ra's spear, Horus returns the weapon to Ra, who uses it to defeat Apophis and open the gates of the underworld once more. After obtaining his other eye from a child, Horus visits Bik and finds out that Set's attack has left him wounded, and he dies in Horus's presence. Horus takes Bik's body to his temple, where Zaya is, and mourns his loss. Ra appears and resurrects Bik and Zaya as a token of gratitude to Horus for his aid. A few days later, Egypt is once again full of life, and all the people have been liberated. Horus is officially crowned king by Thoth, and his first act is to revise the afterlife's regulations. Bik becomes the king's chief advisor, and he hands over the bracelet to Horus so that he can enter the underworld and rescue Hathor. Thanks for watching and subscribe the channel.